dream of Jeannie?
Is Charlene Tilton also Lilton?
Will America salute Indiana Jones?
Can Diane stay in the fast lane?
Is rock ready for the vixen?
Entertainment This Week reveals all the latest to the universe.
I must report to the moon.
Hello, everybody, and thank you for joining us. I'm Dixie Whatley.
And I'm Alan Arthur. This weekend, we've got Tom Selleck, Grace Jones, Bob Hope, and the very latest entertainment news and features from home and abroad.
Our top story has its roots at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. Ronald Reagan parlayed a film career into the nation's top job. Well, these days, lots of actors are mixing politics with show business.
You and you and you and you, you've got a president now. He gave the land a new deal. You hold the cards, now you deal.
Hollywood has a long history of political involvement. In 1920, Al Jolson campaigned for Warren Harding when he ran for president. Dick Powell sang for FDR in support of his 1934 National Recovery Act.
There's an eagle blue in the White House, too, on the shoulder of our president there.
Because of the entertainment industry's wealth and visibility, it exerts a special influence on the political process. A reported 80% of Jerry Brown's 1974 campaign was raised by singer Helen Reddy and her ex-husband manager Jeff Wald. Jane Fonda pumped over $500,000 into her husband's race for a $28,000 a year state assembly seat. And an Eagles concert netted $180,000 for Alan Cranston. A benefit dinner for Gary Hart was held at 20th Century Fox Studios with the support of some of the biggest names in show business.
I'm here to spend some time with Gary and see if he's the kind of guy who can lead us in the direction I would like to see the country going. If so, I will support him and use whatever visibility I have to advance his cause. Then why not? Everybody else does.
I don't think anybody changes the way they're going to vote or decides to vote on the basis of a celebrity endorsement. What celebrities can do is help raise money. They can help attract people who might never come to see a candidate on their own.
Hollywood was well represented at a recent meeting on the U.S. involvement in Central America.
It doesn't matter whether you're an entertainer or an actor or what your degree of celebrity is, you must speak out. You have to speak out.
Speaking out may be hazardous to careers. Some speculate Ed Asner's political views on Central America led to the cancellation of his series, Lou Grant. And there was much controversy over Vanessa Redgrave being cast in Playing for Time because of her support of the PLO.
Anyone who's ever tried to do anything or stand up for anything, you always get the wrath of somebody.
She had a big problem with her own Jane Fonda workout shops because of her political views, and in fact could not go and open some of them.
Paul Newman and Joanne Woodward have always supported the nuclear freeze issue.
If some people complain because I carry more weight than they think my credentials allow, that's their problem. I have five children, and I want to make sure that they don't write on my tombstone that I wasn't part of my time.
Shirley MacLaine is considered to be one of the most outspoken women in Hollywood.
It would be very difficult for me to do a part I don't believe or make a statement that I don't believe. It would also be hard for me not to say what I don't believe. I think that's probably more to the point.
Suddenly you're on the list of people who will do things. Everybody's calling you, and all of a sudden you have stacks of please donate to this or come to that, or, and it's hard not to feel guilty, but I'm not a person that's going to let it ruin my life.
When you're trying to communicate to the masses, you're putting out images a great deal, and you're trying to communicate desperately, and you become image-oriented. So I think politics and show business is all entertainment to a great degree.
It was Nikita Khrushchev who once said, if I had Hollywood, I could win the propaganda battle. And this may well be true. After all, one of the biggest celebrities of Hollywood is now living in the White House. Catherine Mann, Entertainment This Week.
When Ronald Reagan was an actor, the big attraction between movies on Saturday afternoon was the latest episode of those cliffhanger serials. Leonard Maltin looks back.
Indiana Jones is one of the hottest movies of 1984, but its inspiration is a movie genre that dates back 70 years, the cliffhanger serial.
What is it?
There, the Green Archer.
Serials were a movie-going staple from the teens to the mid-1950s, and one studio became synonymous with this brand of entertainment, Republic Pictures.
Today, Republic Pictures is just a memory, but those vintage Saturday matinee serials are still fun to watch.
Of course, the main difference between the cliffhangers of the past and today's Indiana Jones is that the modern version doesn't make you wait a whole week to find out what happened to your hero. But being kept in suspense from one Saturday to the next was a big part of the serial's appeal. Other typical ingredients included a masked villain who isn't exposed until the final chapter.
Well, you're the Wrecker, the man who murdered my father.
A secret society.
The devil's circle is complete.
A hidden treasure.
I found it.
He keeps saying something about having found a lost Aztec mine.
And an exotic setting, be it the Sahara Desert or the underground city of Murania.
Move that way. They'll follow me.
But the most important element was action. Lots of action. The real stars of these serials were the stuntmen who performed incredible feats and didn't rely on camera trickery. When special effects were called for, however, the serials delivered with expertise and imagination that put some big budget movies to shame. The same could not always be said for the acting and dialogue.
This is serious. When Cody did escape, I heard the announcement over the radio. I must report to the moon.
But remember, these serials were part of a simpler time. They were the movie equivalent of Pulp Fiction, and youngsters couldn't get enough of them. They offered thrills, adventure, mystery, and that most valuable movie commodity, escape. It looks as if those ingredients haven't gone out of style. I'm Leonard Maltin, Entertainment This Week.
Well, now a quick look at the coming week in live entertainment, coast to coast, starting in the Big Apple.
This is Lee Leonard in New York, which can be a pretty funny place, in more ways than one, with comedy clubs scattered all over town. On Tuesday, Harry Anderson, comic, street hustler, and TV star, opens for a week at Caroline's on the Lower West Side. Friday and Saturday, Rip Taylor in the Village at the Bitter End. In the theater district, the granddaddy of comedy clubs in New York, The Improvisation, features young comics 7 nights a week. And on the east side, on First Avenue, catch a rising star with a format similar to The Improv, and around the corner on Second Avenue, more of the same at the Comic Strip. Here on First Avenue, Dangerfields, where other name comics work when Rodney is elsewhere, getting some respect. If you get tired of laughing, Willie Nelson's Country Sounds will be at Radio City Music Hall through Tuesday of this week, and Greek singing star Nana Mouskouri will be at Carnegie Hall Tuesday and Wednesday night.
I'm Jean Wolfe. Back in my hometown, I paid a visit to the new Miami Metro Zoo, where you can see animals in a unique cageless environment. And this week, enjoy free concerts by the SOS Band and Pamela Stanley. And there's a lot more happening around the Sunshine State. Donald O'Connor is charming Tampa audiences at the Showboat Theater in Damn Yankees. Burt Reynolds is presenting the musical Stop the World, I Want to Get Off, starring George Chakiris at his Dinner Theater in Jupiter. At Six Flags Atlantis in Hollywood, Michael Jackson's sister LaToya is the headliner. While in Fort Lauderdale, Christine McVie of Fleetwood Mac continues her first solo tour at the Sunrise Theater. And in Orlando, everyone from Lionel Hampton to Buddy Rich will be entertaining in the Epcot World Showcase of Jazz.
Hi, I'm Andrea Joyce reporting from the Mile High City. Denver is ready for summer, and every summer here means the start of the great concert series at the Red Rocks Amphitheater. This natural concert hall, which was formed millions of years ago, will host Joe Jackson on May 31st. In southeast Denver, at the turn of the century, country western singer Mickey Gilley rolls into town June 1st, 2nd, and 3rd. The Denver Center Theater will wrap up its repertory season with final performances of trumpets and drums. And finally, in downtown Denver's historic Larimer Square, Ross Bennett opens at the Comedy Works.
This is Dick Shoemaker in Los Angeles, where this week you have a variety of entertainment choices. Everything from the ballet to a Renaissance pleasure fair to 42nd Street. LA's version of Broadway's 42nd Street plays Tuesday through Sunday. Tickets from $20 to $40 a person at the Schubert Theater. At LA's Music Center, a different kind of dancing, the Joffrey Ballet opens a two-week run starting Wednesday. Seats $10 to $30. And why not something really different? The annual Renaissance Pleasure Fair at the Paramount Ranch, some 40 miles outside of Los Angeles. $11.50 buys a little bit of Elizabethan England every weekend for the adventurers.
Coming up on Entertainment This Week, will Streets of Fire, Diane Lane's 14th film, do the trick?
After 13 films, if you don't have big commercial success, people start wondering, you start wondering, what's wrong?
Which does Bob Hope prefer, the good old days of radio or television today?
Radio was beautiful. You didn't have to worry about makeup. Just run down there, tell the jokes, and kiss the script when they laughed.
And the 60s sitcoms looks back at a favorite comedy. Do you remember?
Oh, Master, you remember?
All this and much more just ahead on Entertainment This Week.
In our celebrity file this week, Grace Jones told us that she notices an air of trepidation from fans when she's performing live. Well, we asked her if she gets the same reaction from friends.
No, my friends, that's a whole other thing. These are people that know all the sweet sides. They know the down-to-earth me. They know the me that giggles, laughs, has a lot of fun.
Tom Selleck has been having a lot of fun on the volleyball court of all places. Besides the good exercise he's getting and fulfilling his duties as spokesman for the U.S. Olympic volleyball team, Selleck sees another benefit from the sport.
As work has become more filled with nonsense, this has been there, and it's great for me. It keeps me normal, like I'm not playing too well right now, and I'm sitting on the bench a little more, so that's good for me, you know. And they don't care whether I'm in a TV show or not.
Kate Capshaw, who co-stars with Harrison Ford in Indiana Jones and who'll be seen in three other movies by year's end, always believed in herself, but she had a little trouble convincing others, particularly an agent friend.
I went in and I said, you know, do you want to handle me? And he said, oh, Kate, you're a little too old, and parts they're just not out there for your age group, and you really should just go back to school. And I went, back to school?
Our series on 60s sitcoms concludes this weekend with a look back at a show that made our guest host, Barbara Eden, a household name.
It's been a while since I've popped in like that. These days, I'm traveling more conventionally, flying into cities to perform Woman of the Year, or walking onto the set to shoot Chattanooga Choo Choo. But in the late 1960s, I got around a little bit differently.
Oh, Master, you remember?
One of the lighthearted and more popular sitcoms of the 60s involved the beautiful Jeannie and her master, an American astronaut. The NBC hit ran for 5 seasons, and my co-star was Larry Hagman.
The time was right for them. The climate of the viewing audience was right for them.
The times were probably right. The country was in the throes of an unpopular war and domestic unrest. But Jeannie was pure fantasy.
Open the window.
Hey, now, wait a minute. I thought we agreed that we weren't going to give each other any elaborate
gifts.
Open the window. Now, if you blink up a car or anything, I'll never forgive you for that.
Along with myself and Larry, the show also starred Bill Daly, the girl-hungry astronaut, and Hayden Rourke as the disbelieving NASA psychiatrist.
All the scripts were very, very severely scrutinized.
by Cape Canaveral and by the Air Force. Number one, not to make me look like an idiot, a psychiatrist, and not to be offensive. And on the other hand, most of all, to appeal to the family theater that they were going to.
Oh, I did not move Niagara Falls, Master. I moved the house.
Although minor, the show was not without some controversy. It seems that the NBC censors were concerned about my skimpy genie costume. I like to think of it as navel gate.
It bordered on the fact that somebody might be offended that if the navel was shown with this extraordinary body in this very exotic genie costume. So they compromised by having it just a 16th of an inch above. And that's a trick holding it on, too, you know.
Did Tony tell you I was sitting in for him tonight?
Well, he is my master. I must do as he says.
I miss that style of freedom. I miss the doing film. And it's working with creative people. And I think you can work that way in a series where two of the people, like Larry and I, can just get together and get in and create things while the camera stands around and then shoot them. You have to come in and everything's planned. And you walk in, you walk from here to there, here, and we're going to do it, and they roll the film. So today, I don't think it can work that way. Because those things we all did on, we just did on Spot, Larry and I. All those shticks we just made up.
I Dream of Jeannie finished its network run in 1970, but the fantasies continue to work their magic in reruns throughout the world.
And that's 60s sitcom. Thanks for joining me all month long. Oh, I'm Barbara Eden.
Monday on NBC, Bob Hope will celebrate his 81st birthday with a few of his closest friends, among them, Brooke Shields.
Hi, everybody. Hi. I'm sorry I'm late. Yeah. Remember when I promised you if you stick with me?
Yeah, that next time you'd pay.
Bob Hope took time out from a schedule that would exhaust a man half his age to talk with Mary Hart.
Nearly 81, Bob Hope has a long career to look back on. He started more than 60 years ago and will always tell you he's been a lucky man.
When you look back at the days of advertising yourself as the song, patter, dance man, did it turn out the way you expected it to?
Well, it turned out better than, you know, I've always been working. I've worked all along. From 1928 on, I've never had a lull. I've been moving to radio and to vaudeville and to Broadway and pictures and television. I've never stopped. I've never had time to even look back, you know, and sit and stand. But when you think back once in a while, when you get a few moments, it's a pretty wonderful thing, you know, to think what's happened in the places you've been, because I've been very, as you said before, am I lucky? I certainly have been lucky in my career and my travels.
Do you ever miss the old radio days?
Yes. Yes, radio was beautiful. You didn't have to worry about makeup. You just run down there and tell the jokes and kiss the script when they laughed. And I love radio. That was the greatest thing of all.
Why, besides the makeup?
Well, radio was an entirely different medium where the audience fantasized and they got their own picture of the scene. You know, when you heard Amos and Andy, for instance, you had your own idea of what the Fresh Air Taxi was and what the Kingfish looked like and what Amos looked like. And you had your own picture. It was a dream. It was a fantasy. And I think that was a great, great medium. It was marvelous. I'm sorry that it's, you know, gone to that extent. It used to be the most fabulous thing in the world.
When do you think you really felt you had the magic combination, that you knew what it was about you that the public loved so much?
I think it was last Thursday. Yeah.
You know, I was going through your itinerary just for the summer, you know, the next few weeks coming up.
Yeah.
And I'm a few months younger than you, and I would be exhausted.
No, you wouldn't. No, you wouldn't. You'd love it. You'd love it. Because I think you got a lot of show business in you, too. And it is not tough for me to play a week like in Westbury and Valley Forge, because you go on at 10 o'clock at night and you get up and you play golf all day. Then you have a massage and you have dinner. Then you walk over to the theater, and the audience is sensational. They greet you, and they laugh, and they cheer. You know, you can't, in our business, you can't do any better than that. I think I'm lucky.
Next, who's doing what to whom, where, how, and why, as we look back at the week's news.
And ahead, Charlene Tilton talks about life as a single mother, a little bit about rock and roll, and her visit with the Pope.
Magrum's Memorial Day Special. Tank top $6.99 to $8.99. Calvin Klein.
Here's a look at the week's entertainment news headlines. CBS filed a motion in federal court asking that the $120 million libel suit filed by General Westmoreland be dismissed before trial. The FCC ruled that Phil Donahue's talk show is a news interview program, and political candidates can appear without equal time for their opponents. A Montreal court placed a temporary injunction on two X-rated videotapes based on the Muppet character Miss Piggy. The World's Fair in New Orleans is having trouble selling tickets. Promoters say about half as many people as expected have gone through the turnstiles. Now the week's top entertainment news stories is covered by our cameras around the world.
Monday, the Ringling Brothers Circus celebrated its 100th birthday.
To a circus fan, why, this is a great thing.
We wouldn't miss any of them.
There are some things that change and some things, gratefully, that do not change.
In San Francisco, rock star Frank Zappa revealed a talent for the classics.
All my orchestral works are for a very large orchestra, so it's expensive to do them. And the arts are very poor in America.
And in Washington, D.C., Ginger Rogers donated her famous dress from Top Hat to the Smithsonian Institution.
This gown is a frail and fragile thing. That it survived the making of Top Hat is almost a miracle in itself.
Tuesday, NBC affiliates got the word from Network Brass about Summer Sunday USA, a news magazine that will go up against 60 Minutes. And the world's most famous duck celebrated birthday number 50.
Donald doesn't look 50 either, does he?
No, I never age.
He never ages.
Wednesday, moviegoers were lined up for the opening of Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom.
It's an event. Everybody goes crazy. It's an event. It feels very different than seeing it later or seeing it any other time.
And College Bowl, a hit TV show in the 50s, came back to NBC for a 30th anniversary celebration.
I've always felt that the moderator had the easiest job of anybody on this program because we always have the answers and the questions, and it's the kids and the other people who put it together who do all the work.
Thursday, the top prize at a French film festival went to a German for a movie about Texas.
Hollywood has isolated itself. Now it begins to realize that the only way that it can survive is to help other film industries survive in all the other countries.
Everybody can work together. It doesn't matter what your language is, what your country is. There are no frontiers in the cinema. There should never be.
And in New York, they handed out Clio's for the best television commercials of the year.
Where's the beef?
Commercials pay the rent when things are real rough.
Well, I think commercials are very important because it gets people out there and they get to see you and they like to see what you do, and if they like what you do, then they let you do other things if you get to do other things.
Friday, soul singer Teddy Pendergrass, injured 2 years ago in a car crash, was the main attraction at a New York party toasting his new record.
What he's gone through in his life and how he's overcome it is only inspiration to all of us who think we have problems.
It always feels good to be in New York, especially when it's your party.
The Broadway musical Nine opened in Los Angeles. And in New York, The Wiz came back to Broadway. And that's a look at the week's entertainment news in pictures.
Mention the Smithsonian Institution and visions of fossils and archives come to mind. Well, you now know that Ginger Rogers' dress is in the Smithsonian. Patrick Collins has come up with a lot more showbiz at the museum.
What to keep? What to save? What to keep? What to save? What to keep? What to save?
Hey, you wouldn't expect me to throw away treasures like this, would you?
Just about everybody's got something they're never going to use, but for one reason or another, they'll never part with. It's an American tradition. We save everything.
Except maybe money.
But nobody saves quite like the Smithsonian's Museum of American History, and lately it's become the country's attic of entertainment. We're not talking reproductions here. They've got the original, bona fide, A-number one top drawer stuff. The right stuff. This here hat was worn by one of the most famous Texans of all time. The president of Ewing Oil. Here we have Dorothy's ruby slippers.
Not Toto, too?
Not Toto, too. Ah, if ties could only talk, the stories they could tell. This one, you see, was once worn by old Blue Eyes himself. And the one next to it? Well, that's Rodney Dangerfield's. But even if that could talk, it still wouldn't get no respect. And just last week, they got Ginger Rogers' gown.
We collect programs, posters, playbills, costumes, props, even fragments, architectural fragments of theaters.
They've got Archie's chair, Hawkeye's swamp, and Jimmy Durante's hat.
10 years from now, there's no telling what they might have here. Michael Jackson's glove. Howard Cosell's toupee. Johnny Carson's divorce settlement. Boy George's eyelash. Gee, you don't suppose they might have room for this, do you?
Absolutely not.
Next, Charlene Tilton, a candid interview with the woman who plays J.R.'s manipulative niece on Dallas.
And ahead, what's new in Nashville? Music City is also becoming Museum City. Charlene Tilton was born December 1st, 1959 in San Diego. Her daughter Cherish is 21 months old. She collects Barbra Streisand and Mary Pickford memorabilia.
Charlene Tilton is truly a child of Hollywood. She grew up in Hollywood and attended Hollywood High. She made her first appearance in a Disney film while still a student. Finally, after small parts in several TV shows, she was cast in a series. Dallas went on the air in April 1978 with Charlene as luscious Lucy Ewing, J.R.'s manipulative niece, a role many actresses coveted, but Tilton made uniquely her own.
He's not coming to Southport just to work with John Ross. Coming here to be with you. Just how long have you two been having this little affair, huh?
What?
Lucy, you're drunk. So what? I might be drunk, but I'm sure not blind. At least not anymore.
On Valentine's Day, 1982, she married country singer Johnny Lee. They have a 21-month-old daughter, Cherish. Last December, citing irreconcilable differences, she filed for divorce. Tilton just returned from Europe, where she cut her first record and is now at work on her seventh Dallas season. She's here in the studio for a one-on-one interview with Dixie.
Thank you, Alan. Charlene, I understand you just got back from your first trip to Europe.
I did. We were there for a month, so it was really great.
Was it just pleasure, or was there a little business in
there? No, it was mostly business.
A little pleasure in there, then?
A little bit of pleasure. No, the first part of the trip, we started off in Paris, and I was doing some modeling. And I worked with the designer Koresh, modeling some of his clothes and doing publicity for Dallas and getting to see a little bit of Paris. And then we went to Rome, where I had an audience with the Pope, which was great. And that was fantastic. We were at the Vatican, and he blessed my daughter. He kissed Cherish and spoke to us a little bit. Then we went to Milan, Barcelona, and then spent most of the rest of the trip in Germany, all over Germany, promoting a new record I did.
Is it a new career direction for you?
I don't know. I had never thought about doing it until after Dallas, but the opportunity arose that we could do it now. So we took it, and Thank God it's going very well. The record is expected to go on the charts any minute in Germany.
Are you a little scared? I would think that many times when you're so well known for one thing, you say, hey, I'm going to go sing. You never get the chance to warm up into it. It's like as soon as you do something, you're out there in front of the world.
Yeah, I was scared. I was petrified. We did. We recorded the record here in Los Angeles. And at the same time, Michael Jackson was right next door recording. So that was kind of intimidating. But it was nice getting to meet him. And yeah, that was intimidating. But boy, once I got on the stage and started singing and the audience reaction, I loved it.
Did Michael Jackson give you any pointers?
No. He signed some autographs and we talked a little bit.
That's not bad. Were you ever surprised at some point when all of a sudden, worldwide, you're being acclaimed as a beauty? Is that something that you always accepted, or did you go through a period when you were a kid going, oh, I'm not cute or I'm not pretty, and all of a sudden the whole world is saying you're beautiful? What's that like to deal with?
I don't know. I still go through that. So, I don't know. I don't really pay attention to it yet. It's part of my job. It's like I can't always eat what I want. Always have to watch the weight. Always have to, you know, worry about getting enough sleep, you know, for looking good. Or sometimes I feel that there's too much emphasis placed on that. But it's my job, so I have to.
How does it feel when you're walking by a magazine rack and there you are looking back at you?
Oh, I love seeing myself splattered all over the Enquirer. That just makes my day. Every time I see that, I go, oh, thank you, God. No, I hate that. The other magazines I like, the tabloids, no.
How do you deal with that? It seems like when you're a public figure like you are, you can't sneeze without being in a tabloid.
Oh, it's unbelievable. It's, I think it's very dangerous. I really do. It's very negative. It's very dangerous. Most of the things are really not true at all. Or if there's any grain of truth, it's lost in a full page of lies. So it's, I think it's really bad. And their tactics are deplorable, the way they go about getting stories and what they do.
What have they used on you?
Oh, gosh, I don't know. I think I might hold the record of covers of the Enquirer. But, you know, there's times when they go through your garbage to find things. I mean, they call people in line. They say they're from different magazines. They call, you know, they get your phone number through the phone company. They do all kinds of nasty things.
How is that? I know you've been going through some difficult times lately, and, you know, certainly it's been plastered all over everything, just like the rest. How has that added to it? Has that made it even more difficult in a relationship?
Sure. I'm not made out of stone. It hurts me when I see things, you know, especially that aren't true. And when I see bad things, oh, yeah, it hurts a lot. I'm not hardened to that yet. I haven't been in this business long enough to, you know, put up a shield and just say, well, it doesn't bother me, because it does.
How did you deal with it when you're, you know, you're together and you read things about one another? How do you straighten it all out?
Well, you mean in reference to Johnny, mm-hmm. Johnny and myself? We've talked about it. In fact, this week, lo and behold, we're on the cover again. And he, you know, he called up and said, well, this was in the supermarket, and looks like we made the Enquirer again. So I don't even read them anymore. I just have to quit looking at them.
It'd be so difficult.
Yeah.
How are you dealing with it now with Cherish? Is he able to talk together, and does he see her a lot and everything?
He talks with us, and he talks to her, and sees her whenever he can, when he's in town.
How do you think it's going to be as you're facing being a single parent, having her grow up and dealing with that?
Well, I'm very fortunate that because of my job, that I can work out a schedule that we can spend a lot of time together. I was raised my mother was a single parent, and it was just me, my mother and myself. And there was a lot of love in that home, even though it was just the two of us. So,
do you think in some ways it cuts distractions, that the focus is there more when it's just the two of you?
No, I think there's definitely an element missing. I think every child needs both parents.
Are you scared to start dating again?
I haven't even begun to think about that. It's too soon. I'm, you know, I'm still going through a lot of hurt and stuff, so I'll have to wait and see.
Has it soured you at all in marriage?
No, I would like to get married again. But like I said, I can't think about that yet.
The line will form to the left outside the studio as soon as I'm there. Thank you, Charlene. And we'll leave you with a taste of Charlene's new single, C'est la Vie, for the first time on national TV. Coming up next, Leonard Maltin with some good news and some bad news about what's new at the movies.
And ahead, Diane Lane, a young and veteran actress, hopes her new movie will put her on the top. Summer movie season is upon us, and so is Leonard Maltin with a roundup of the newest in neighborhood theaters around the country.
A new Steven Spielberg movie is always an event, and this weekend we lead off our movie review with a look at his latest blockbuster. Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom is an action-packed sequel to Raiders of the Lost Ark, with Harrison Ford in fine fettle as the 1930s archaeologist and adventurer. But Steven Spielberg's film is too much of a good thing. An overdose of full-throttle action and gross-out material that never gives you a chance to breathe. Firestarter not only gives you a chance to breathe, but to laugh right out loud at its supremely silly story and dialogue. Drew Barrymore is the incendiary star of Stephen King's story, but once you've seen her set cinder blocks ablaze, you've seen the best this film has to offer. Finders Keepers offers all the ingredients of a perfect farce, but ends up like a fallen souffle. Michael O'Keefe, Louis Gossett Jr., and Beverly D'Angelo star in this comic misfire, directed by Richard Lester, about a motley group of people chasing a coffin full of money. Robert Redford is a heavy hitter, and he's perfectly cast in The Natural, as a boy from the sticks with a gift for playing baseball. But the film itself is a mixed blessing, deviating from Bernard Malamud's book with heavy doses of sentiment and larger-than-life characters. For a movie that's entertaining and doesn't insult your intelligence, I'd recommend Moscow on the Hudson, with Robin Williams in a terrific performance as a Russian defector who learns about life in the USA. It's a winning comedy drama that's well worth your time and money. That's our weekend movie wrap-up. I'm Leonard Maltin, Entertainment This Week.
Well, moviegoers everywhere are lining up to see Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom, so we went to Chicago for some first-hand reactions.
It was terrific. Adventures from the beginning to the end. It will keep you on the edge of your seat.
Oh, that was great. I'll see it 17 times at least.
It wasn't as good as Raiders, but it was fun.
I'm exhausted. It's nonstop.
I thought it was excellent. It was so good. The thing is, it was a little gory. I had my hands in front of my eyes most of the time.
Did the violence trouble you at all?
No. This is pure adventure with escapism. It's wonderful.
It is a little bit too violent. I think they could have cut out some of it. And I was interested in the note in the program that said that the film may be a little too intense for young children. I think that's true. But it's a terrific movie.
I didn't think it was that good.
Now, here's what audiences surveyed around the country by Movie Track felt about the latest adventures of Indiana Jones. 14% of the audience surveyed by Movie Track called it the best, while another 59% said they loved it, and 21% liked it. Now, that's the good news. 5% were sorry they came, and only 1% rated it a bomb. Now, based on Movie Track's report, we predict Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom will do big business, but will fall short of the box office landslide of Raiders.
Diane Lane is an actress who, despite many films, isn't that well known. Now she's hoping her new movie, Streets of Fire, will set her career on fire.
13 films later in 5 years, I think I've been working, you know, which is nice to say, considering, you know, there's a lot of unemployed people in my field.
Diane Lane made her movie debut in the critically acclaimed A Little Romance. She was 13 years old and was already a veteran of more than 2,000 live stage performances, but still isn't widely recognized as a celebrity.
It's just that after 13 films, if you don't have big commercial success, people start wondering, you start wondering, what's wrong?
In the upcoming Streets of Fire, Lane may have finally found a commercially successful vehicle.
I'm Ellen Aim of Ellen Aim and the Attackers, and I'm a rock singer, supposedly. And it was wild to do that in the spotlight and wriggle around. And actually, I always wanted to be a singer.
But Lane's voice won't be heard in the movie. The work of three professional singers has been dubbed in instead. In Streets of Fire, Lane's character is kidnapped by a motorcycle gang. In real life, Lane comes from a broken home. Her mother was once accused of kidnapping her in a custody battle.
When you live through a lot of traumatic experiences, whether they're very happy or very sad or just powerful feelings, and you can't do anything about them, they shock you and they stay in you, and they like reverberate around inside, and they're there to work from if you need them.
Streets of Fire, which co-stars Michael Paré, is almost certain to bring her considerable attention. She says that she's not exactly looking forward to it.
I think it's very flattering when somebody is, you know, likes my work and says, I think you're great, that's fine. But I can't relate to, you know, publicizing my image and my persona and having people think they know me as, you know, what is a Diane Lane? My dad's always saying, you gotta figure it out so you can tell the people, what is a Diane Lane? And I don't know, you know, I don't know how to sum it up like that. I'll write a book one day.
Coming up next week on Entertainment Tonight, Monday, Larry Hagman. How much longer does he plan to play J.R.?
Tuesday, Andy Warhol directs a new Cars video. How far out can a music video be?
Wednesday, Julio Iglesias. He made it to the top of the charts with Willie Nelson. Now, can he make it on his own?
Thursday, Paul Anka. How does a former teen idol keep coming up with new hits?
Friday, David Lee Roth. Does Van Halen's lead singer do all his own stunts, musical and physical? Next week on Entertainment Tonight. Nashville is known as the country music capital of the world. It may soon be called the country museum capital of the world. Elaine Gannick has more.
Here at Music Village USA, located just north of the city, last-minute construction is underway on two new facilities. At the Marty Robbins Memorial Showcase, we found Ronnie Robbins supervising preparations for exhibits which pay tribute to his late father's life.
We've been working around the clock, and I'm really pleased with the way things have been coming together, and I really think Daddy would be pleased with this, too.
Just next door, the Ferlin Husky Wings of a Dove Museum, named after the singer's 1960 million-selling record, is nearing completion. Inside, the religiously-oriented sculptures were created by Paul Cunningham, who in the early 1930s worked on the Mount Rushmore Monument. In the heart of town, Barbara Mandrell has just opened this new facility, and the outlaw himself, Waylon Jennings, has announced plans to bring items from his private collection to his new museum here on Music Row.
Things like the gun from Shane that Alan Ladd used, and I've got a walking cane that Andrew Jackson made, and I've got pigtails from Willie Nelson.
Finally, Lionel Richie, okay, whose songs have been giant successes in both the pop and country field, took time out during his Nashville concert this week to donate one of his stage costumes to the Country Music Wax Museum.
Lionel Richie is a country artist. I don't know, but it's a great honor, and I guess it pays off to be from Tuskegee, Alabama.
Guess so. All female rock bands are the Rodney Dangerfields of the music business. They just get no respect. The latest making the bid for the big time is doing so with a different tack, the movies.
Wild. Dangerous. Unpredictable.
They are Vixen, an all-girl group formed 7 years ago. You told me. They are also Hardbodies. That is, they play a rock group called Hardbodies in the current movie called Hardbodies. And the producers decided it would be easier to teach musicians to act rather than the other way around.
It's more natural to see real musicians playing than having actresses, because they won't hold the instruments right, they won't look right, they won't have the same, you know, intensity about it. It would be the Hollywood version of, you know, it would be fake, you know. And besides, they can have us.
Do you feel at all exploited being a group called Hardbody?
Well, we're the ones in the movie with our clothes on. That's how you know us.
Yeah.
I mean,
we're the
Both looking and sounding good got them the film role, but Vixen has found that being attractive women can be a problem.
A lot of times people are real skeptical when they first, you know, see us walk on stage. They kind of, they're going to play rock and roll. Okay. You know, but by the end, they, you know, they come around.
What kind of problems do you run into being an all-woman band?
Well, a lot of times we'll get the line like, you're good for girls. You know, they can't, some people can't just say we're good musicians. Also, a lot of record companies will, if they already have a female group, they'll think that's all they can have. They'll have 500 guy bands. And they'll go, well, we've already got this female band. We've got one female band, and, you know, so that's it.
I grew up playing, learning to play, just like any little boy would. You know, I had all the albums, and I played and practiced 8 hours a day.
It's really not that different. You know, you do have a little more, people give you a little bit more of a hard time than, you know, than a guy, but in a way it makes you more determined.
And like any band, when they tour, which is often, they have fans. And some of the fans give them some rather personal gifts.
Somebody gave me tonsils.
That's personal.
Yeah. Hey.
Like in a jar?
Yeah.
In a jar.
Tonsils in a jar.
If the music doesn't pan out, can you see becoming actresses?
Hey, I want my own musical cooking show. You know?
So where do you want your careers to go?
To the top.
That's going to do it for this show. But next weekend, funny man George Carlin and big man Wilt Chamberlain.
Easy ever. And Monday on Entertainment Tonight, Larry Hagman talks about staying at home on Dallas for a long time.
Bye-bye.
Everybody's clapping for their favorite music video show, New York Hot Tracks. Each week, video disc jockey Carlos De Jesus brings you today's hottest videos, world premieres, and your favorite stars, all from New York City's hottest clubs. Get on the right track with New York Hot Tracks.
Saturday nights at 1 a.m. on Channel 5.
That'd be a rated PG.